Hi, I'm Erika, the Senior SAT and ACT Curriculum Manager at Magoosh. I've written and taught a lot of ACT math questions over the years, and I found that regardless of skill or level, there's one big mistake that pretty much all students make, and that's solving for the wrong thing. In this video, we're going to walk through problems from Magoosh's online ACT program to explain why this is such a common ACT math mistake and demonstrate three strategies you can use to avoid making it. Let's examine just the first two lines for a second. What's your first instinct when you see a system of equations? Probably substitution or elimination to solve for either x or y, right? So let's imagine a scenario where we go with that instinct and we immediately launch in with substitution or elimination because that's what we normally do. If we solve for y, we get negative 2, which, hey, that's answer choice B. But hold up, we never even read the third line of the question. We're not solving for y. We're solving for x plus y. We very nearly picked an answer without ever knowing what we were supposed to be doing. And because we saw our solution in the answer choices, we might have moved on convinced we got the question right. Now, the same trap applies when we solve for x. We get 9, which we see in answer choice E. So this is obviously dangerous. The test makers intentionally build in trap answer choices that are the solutions to similar but different questions. So the best way to avoid this is to be proactive, which leads us to our first strategy. When you read the problem, make note of what you're solving for somewhere on your paper before you start solving. I personally like to circle it in the question or in my own notes on the problem. By doing this, we ensure that we actually read what the question is asking for rather than make an assumption about it. So for this problem, rather than immediately launching in with substitution or elimination, we'll make sure we read the whole problem and circle x plus y. Now that we've taken the time to make note of this, we're much less likely to fall into the traps of B and E. Another great thing about this strategy, though, is that it gives us a chance to think about our approach before rushing into solving. With this problem, for instance, we can get to x plus y by solving for x, and then y, and then adding them together, but it's slow. And if we lose track of what we're doing along the way, we still might answer for just x or just y. But if we note that we're solving for x plus y before we start substituting or eliminating, we might consider seeing if we can solve directly for x plus y. And this leads us to adding the equations together, giving 3x plus 3y equals 21. Divide both sides by 3, and you've got x plus y equals 7, or D. Way more efficient and much less error-prone. Let's take a look at another example problem to dig into our second strategy. All right, so we're gonna be careful here. They're asking for the slope of a line that is perpendicular to 4x minus 6y equals 14. Notice if we were moving quickly, we may have totally skipped over this word perpendicular, much like we skipped over x plus y in the last problem, but not this time. So if the slope of this line is m, the slope of a perpendicular line will be the negative reciprocal, or negative 1 over m, circling that. So first step, we need to get m, or the slope of this line. Let's start by getting this equation into slope-intercept form, or y equals mx plus b. So we'll subtract 4x on both sides, then we'll divide by negative 6 on both sides. That's not super pretty, so let's simplify. And our m, or our slope, is 2 over 3, which we see in answer choice A. But wait. That's not what we were solving for. That's the slope of this line, not our perpendicular line. So notice that even if we correctly know what we're solving for in the beginning, we can forget about it or get too eager and lose track of our goal. Just like we could have on the last problem if we didn't catch on to the trick of adding the equations together and instead solve for x and y individually. Again, note that the test maker has built in this intermediate step as an answer choice with the intention of trapping us here. So we're going to build on our previous strategy with our second strategy. Before picking an answer choice, look back to make sure that what you have is what you were supposed to be solving for. Since we've already noted it on our paper, this step is surprisingly quick for how effective it is. Let's demonstrate with this problem. So, okay, I solved for m, but based on my circled portion, I really want the negative reciprocal of m. So I plug in what I have for m. There's a negative. Go ahead and flip it. And my answer is B. This took an extra 5 seconds and it saved me the problem. All right, last example for our last strategy. We know that Sue paid $180 for a lawnmower after a 25% discount, and we're looking for the original price of that lawnmower before the discount was applied. So let's call that P and we'll go ahead and circle it. Okay, great, but what does that mean? Interpreting exactly what this problem is asking us to solve for in terms of math, like we did in the last problem, is made more difficult by the fact that this is a word problem. We don't have a nice definition like negative reciprocal to rely on. So let's walk through a common mistake. We go, okay, original price minus 25% is 180. So original price equals 180 plus 25%. And 25% of 180 is 40. And 180 plus 40 is 220. And we see that in answer choice B. Now, this time, before we pick B, we also look back at what we're solving for. Okay, we have P and we're solving for P, so we should be good to go, right? But maybe we're not convinced. So what we're gonna do here is use our third and final strategy, which is do a logical check. Now, often people think checking your work means doing the same math all over again, but that's only gonna catch calculation errors, not errors in logic. What I'm gonna do here is check if my answer makes logical sense. For this problem, a great way of doing that is plugging it back into the problem. So if my original price is actually $220 and I take a 25% discount, that's one-fourth off or $55 off, which would mean Sue should pay $165, and that's not $180. Huh. And here I see my mistake. I originally took 25% of $180 rather than 25% of that unknown original price, or P. So I thought I solved for the original price, P, but I actually solved for something totally different. Yikes. So now I can either build an algebraic equation using my newfound understanding of the situation, or I can use the logical check method to keep testing answer choices until I get the correct one. Either way, I'll eventually get to D. 25% of 240 is $60, and 240 minus 60 is 180. So that's my correct answer. And those are the three strategies to avoid solving for the wrong thing on ACT math. Noting what we're solving for on our paper before we dive in, looking back at what we're solving for before we select an answer, and employing logical checks to ensure that our answer makes sense. To stay updated with all of our upcoming videos, like this video and hit the subscribe button. And if you have any questions or suggestions for future videos, leave us a comment down below. Talk to you soon.